Precious. Page 165. Page 165. Kneel at the cross. Cross will meet you there. Come while he waits for you. List to his voice. Leave with him your care.
Appreciate each and every one that's come out to be with us tonight. Be much in prayer for those that's not here. God knows who they are, where they're at, what's going on in their lives to keep them from being here tonight. But for those of us that are here, let's just enjoy the Lord. Amen. Let's enjoy everything that he does and everything he says for us to do. We appreciate you. Maybe somebody tonight has a song on your heart, something you'd like to do for the Lord this evening. Hearts and minds clear? Word or testimony? Amen. Appreciate that. Anybody else? If not, this is our Wednesday night Bible study, and we always open up with altar prayer. So before we do that, maybe somebody has a special object of prayer on your heart. Mandy with two E's. Cornette with two T's. Skip. You spell that. Amen. I'm like a guy I seen the other day. He said he had a cup of coffee. He's ordering coffee, and he said that was Mark with a C. And they put C-A-R-K. Who was that? Yeah, I think she's on here somewhere. It's her or her husband. She's got 6 months. So let's remember that. Anybody else? I think so, but if I see it, I'll scratch Miles Chicken Scratch out. Who? Peggy Main. Family, pray for the family. Peggy Main. Did she say she passed away, or she just? Yes, to her family. I'm assuming George is doing better. She's still good. Well, somebody told me she didn't know any other name. She didn't know her real name. Well, let's don't go down that route, because I know there's a lot of us others that would deserve the same thing. Anybody else tonight? If not, there's plenty on our prayer list. Do be much in prayer for each and every one of them. Pray for us that we'd be what God would have us to be. Pray for the church. We do want to we wish you all a happy Thanksgiving before y'all go in. Some of you go in the back, but just remember to thank the Lord for all his blessings that he does for us. Everybody that can and will, we'll gather around the altar and we'll go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to you tonight, Lord, to humble ourselves before thee. Lord, thanking you for another day and another opportunity, God, just to be able to gather out on this side of eternity, Lord. Now, dear Heavenly Father, we pray for those that's on this prayer list, Lord. We pray for the Peggy Maines family. Pray for Ralph Mink, Diane Eisenhower, Dolores Anderson, Brooke Hutchison, Clifton and Adam Worley, Eddie Bentley, Haley Adams, Judy Davis, Kevin Menard, the Reason family, Levi Ashley, Kelly Sluder, David Wilson, Doug Taylor, Helen Duggar, Cindy, Ashley and Riley, Kelly Odom, June Campbell, Daniel Furches, Danny McAlay, Tammy Taylor, Blake and Joan Atwood, Joan Pope, Randy Jennings, Larry Hawkins, Willie Gray Adams, Harold and Shirley Rash, Jody Dunn, Angie Doherty, Michaela Taylor, Robert Sutherland, Ryland Main, Joe McCress, Ralph Hutto, Doug and Mary Miller, Francis Dowell, Dennis Lewis, Willie, the Rupert family, Leanna Vault, and Lord, we thank you for helping her, Bobby Joe Eller, Carl Wiggins, Andy Lowe, Judy Campbell and sister, Ryan, Mike Reynolds, Lucas Barnett, Brother Eddie's family, Ebenezer Christian Home, and all those children, God, Tony Jennings, Dave Salt, Sue Hensley, Dorothy Keller, Danny Buchanan, Linda McCullough, Lucas Perdue, Judy Owens, William Williams, Harley Rankin, Ben Bowers, Ken and Janie Head, Mandy Fleming, Lester Dunn, Will Gregg, Sanford Humphrey and Sanford and Jane Humphrey, Sue Williams, Frank and Joetta Main, Brenda Lutzford, Andy Osborne, Cliff Tressler, Diane Harmon, Ava Reiner, Emily Church, Osborne family, Gwen Lewis, Abram Whitson, Gary Buchanan, Steve's mother-in-law, Michelle Worley, David Ward, pray for our wife, pray for Crystal Owens, Bronson Alexander, Ross Dow, Willis Lewis, Patty Osborne, Elaine Kirby, Aaron Steele, Randy Lewis, Luella Dunn, Delilah Campbell, Buffy Cornett, Loretta, Wendell Carraway, Carol Mast, Dustin Rankin, Alyssa's dad, Mike Lipford, Richard Stidham, Brother Danny, Cornette, Margaret Eisenhower, Bob Miller and wife, Nancy Bunning, John Yates, Paul Grable's wife, Bud Crosswhite, Gene Buchanan, Nathaniel Rice, Brianna Poor, Unspoken Request, Tammy Thomas, Israel, and all the wars that's going on around our world, Lord, Ronnie Henson, Teresa Riley, Carolyn Porter, Savannah Maines, Zach Walton, Donna Taylor, Mandy Crenap, Skip Roderick. Lord, you know all the ones. It's the things that we've just read off tonight. God, you know everything about them. You know what they're facing and what they're going through. I pray to Heavenly Father that you'll just help each one the way that you see fit. Now, Lord, be at the services tonight, God. Take your word up into our minds and our hearts. Help us to grow by it, and we give you the glory. Not our will be done, but thine. In Jesus' blessed name we pray. Amen. M-A-Y. Gotcha. I'm sorry, honey. I'm deaf. May. What about Francis now? They shocked her heart. Amen. Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's great. That's great. We'll leave her on there for another week or two. We'll. Yeah. Right. He ain't near as old as Don. Yeah. Yeah. You get as old as Don, you'd have to be dirt. 93 next month. I tell you, that's a blessing, isn't it? Amen. God's blessed. Anybody else? Anything else that's on your heart? If not, this is our Wednesday night Bible study, and we're over in the book of Ephesians, chapter number 4. I think we got down through verse number 12 last week, or last time we were together, and we're going to be picking back up here at verse number 13. And we just want to say that and do that which God would have us do. Paul's writing unto them, telling them how we should be. And this scripture tonight, it's going to show us and teach us that we need to, it's going to show us and teach us that we don't need to stay complacent. Amen. We don't need to stay where we are, but we need to learn and move and grow. Amen. And it's important for us to do that. And we'll start here in verse number 13. The Bible says, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto a measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Paul's telling us here, he's writing unto us, said, look, we are to keep these things, we are to do these things, and we are to live this way until we become perfect. Now listen, we're not going to become perfect here on this earth. Now I know some folks, and some one at least may even be among us who thinks they're perfect, amen. But I can tell you right now, there are none of us perfect. But that does not give us, that does not let us off, that teaches us off the hook. But we are to strive for perfection, amen. We are to strive to be perfect. I'm telling you, it's important that we live our lives the way God has instructed us to live. It's important that we do those things because it helps us each day to draw up a little closer and to know and to do that which He has for us to do. Amen. If we'll live closer and be in the unity, oneness and harmony among the believers is possible if we are serving and striving for the same thing. Amen. We have to be, and I think that's another reason that the church has to be sound in the doctrinal teachings that it has. We have to be sound and stand together on the things that this Bible tells us is so. Amen. Look, it don't matter whether I like it or whether I don't like it. Whether I agree with it or I don't agree with it. And we're going to get into a little more about growth here in a little bit. But this Bible right here equips us to give us the ability to faith, be faithful in serving and to grow spiritually if we'll live by it. I sent you out a text, I believe it was yesterday, it says you've heard that it has been said to love thine enemy, or love thy brother and hate thine enemy. You say, well, here's what I want to tell you. I've been battling all week with some things at work. People trying to be dishonest and people trying to say the wrong things and even accusing me of some things that was not so. And I've done my best not to take a sledgehammer to a fly, amen. And I told Melissa yesterday, I said, people don't make it easy, amen. People don't make it easy not to live what the Bible tells us to do. He tells us to love thine enemy. And I tried my best. I think I did a pretty decent job of keeping my cool, and things were beginning to turn around and work back out the way they're supposed to work out. But if we had a flew off and done the wrong things or said the wrong. It's easy to get mad and aggravated. But if we'll never be in the unity that God wants us to if we just are one-sided. Amen. If it has to be my way or no way. Amen. I listened to a preacher out of Middle Tennessee, and he says it like this. He said, everybody wants church to be Burger King. Have it your way, amen. He said, I'm from the old school. He said, I'd rather have it the Wendy's way, hot and juicy, amen. We are to be in unity and striving for the same thing, not just about what it is for us, and not just about the church here, but for us to really be in fellowship, and for us to really be striving and have the joy in our heart that God wants us to, we are to be striving for the same thing reaching outside of these walls. We are to be trying to reach the lost and those things. And not only that we come in unity, but of the perfect, of the knowledge of the Son of God. It's not just, and I don't think what Paul was talking about here. Paul was talking to believers. I don't think he was talking to them that they had to come to know the Lord personally. I don't think that's what he was, what the conversation, it wasn't about salvation. Let me say it that way. I believe what he was talking about was the knowledge of the Son of God. He was talking about that we had a deeper understanding of what it meant to walk with Christ. A deeper understanding of who Jesus really is. Now, we all live in a world that wants the Jesus of miracles. We all live in a world of people that want Jesus for all the things that he can do for them in their life. But what we don't realize is that we are servants, that he was a servant. He came to serve what the Father said and to serve you and I. Bible tells us, gives us a great example about him washing the disciples' feet. And he said the master is the servant as well. Amen. We are here. We are to follow his rule, or his example of what he set for us. If we want to be in perfect unity of the faith, and we have to have the knowledge of God unto a perfect man, under the measure and the stature of the fullness of Christ. What does that tell us? It tells us, hey, that we ought to be doing everything that we can, that our life ought to look like Christ. To live a Christian life in the word itself and the definition of the word is for us to be Christ-like. And for us to walk that way means we're going to walk the way Christ would have walked. We're going to go the way Christ would have went. We're going to say the things that Christ would have. Now, we are going to mess up. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 8, verse 29, he said this, for whom he did foreknow, he also did predestinate to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. There's a lot in that scripture. In other words, God knew and he saved us. We were saved to become like Christ, to follow after him. But did you notice in the last part of that verse, said that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. In other words, that he might be born again, that he might be saved, that he might be the first one out there leading many others to get saved. And if we want them to get saved and we want them to have what we have and we don't want to see them go to hell, then we are to be different than what the world is. We are to be different than what everybody else. It's easy. Listen, it's easy to get mad and frustrated and do and say the wrong things. James said it best. Let us be swift to hear and slow to speak and slow to wrath. Amen. Now I know it's hard sometimes, but and I have as hard a time as anybody. Listen, I got a big mouth. I don't know if y'all noticed that or not. But I've got a big mouth, and I don't care one bit to share it with folks. But I'm doing my best to be swift to hear and slow to speak. That's a hard thing for somebody like me. But God said, he that can bridle the mouth can bridle the whole body. I'm still working on it. But I think we all ought to be working on things in our life that'll help us to become better Christians. Amen. That'll help us to become better Christians. Be no more children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine, by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive us. Listen, the old devil doesn't. Do you think all these things happen to us by accident? Look, the old devil knows what pushes our buttons. Amen. The old devil will take things and use those things against us. He knows what makes us mad. And look, we have to go through some things in this life that'll help us to grow. The other night, I was telling somebody. I think it was Sunday at the dinner. Saturday, Melissa and I went to town, and on our way back from Johnson City, we was coming through Elizabeth in there, and we come to a stop sign, and there was a car in front of us, and that car did not pull out, even though it had plenty of room to pull out. There were some cars coming, but they was way on up the road. And I told Melissa, I said, if this car don't go this time, I'm blowing the horn. She looked at me, and she told me, she said, you are so impatient. Why do you get so impatient with these things? I said, look, okay, all right. I didn't blow the horn. Person went on. I got out. I went around them. We got coming around the lake. Was coming up around the three lane. You know how it is when you get to the three lane and two people get side by side and won't nobody go on. I didn't say a word. We got behind the car. This car wasn't doing the speed limit. This car was doing about 20 miles an hour. All around the road we got, all the way up almost into Butler. Melissa said, this person needs to go on. I said, you are so impatient. What is wrong with you? Why do you do that? Listen, hey, we are to set the example. Amen, right? Look, we all get in the same situations. And sometimes, what was pushing my button in Elizabeth, she didn't have that problem. But when they wouldn't go on around the lake, she didn't like that. Amen? Look, we all have issues. The old devil knows exactly where to push our buttons. Hey, let me tell you something. God wants us to be able to handle those things. He wants us to grow that we might be able to handle those things. Hey, it takes some growth in our lives. I'll use that as just a small example. But he told us to be no more children. He doesn't want us tossed to and fro. He doesn't want us to believe what this bunch believes and then go over here and believe what this bunch believes and then believe what that bunch says. Hey, you want to know the best way to know what God wants you to know? It's to pick up this book and read it. Amen? Because if it don't line up with this book, it ain't right anyway. You can value all kinds of men's opinion. Man, look. I can tell you right now, some of the best people that do some of the best things, sometimes they're going to let you down. Sometimes they're going to make mistakes because they don't listen to what's going on and listen to what God says. Amen. What the book is, what they're trying to tell them. Bible tells us right there, he said, there should be no more children tossed to and fro. We can get around the wrong crowds, and we can hang around the wrong people, and we can not grow in the knowledge of the Lord. Look, if you don't read your Bible at home, if you don't listen to good preaching and be around good Christian people and good Christian music, then you can be carried away with every whim, everything that's going on in this world. Look, if you listen to all different kinds of music, then you can be carried away with things of the world. He told us there not to be carried away, not by the sleight of men. Now, listen, people, not everybody are who they say they are. Not everybody has good intentions that lets on like they have good intentions. And also, the same thing goes for us as Christians. If we never grow in the Lord, we can be very gullible. We can be very persuasive to follow the wrong crowd and follow the wrong things. Amen. Listen, we've got a world full of, and we've got a county full of contemporaryism and contemporary churches and things that have gone the way that the world is. I mean, if you didn't have church over the door, you probably wouldn't even know there was a church. Amen? If they didn't tell you there was, you'd never notice that they were. God wants us to be different. He doesn't want us to be foolish. He doesn't want us to be carried away with all these whims of doctrines and different things. Mark 13:22 says this, for false Christ and false prophets shall rise and shall show signs and wonders to seduce, if it were where possible,
even the elect. Amen. It amazes me of how many Christian people go right along with crazy things. Aaron, our youngest son, he's in. He's back. He's in Tennessee. He's at the house this afternoon for a little while, and we're sitting there watching TV a minute, watching the news, and there was something come on about about people was had been fooled by sending money, and I Melissa tells us about it all the time. She sees people all the time that give their money away. Most of the time, it's elderly people that believe they got to send their money to this or send their money for that. They lose all their savings. And me, from a rational side of things, I think, man, you ain't getting my money. I mean, you're going to have a hard... Look, I'm married to a banker. You're going to have a hard time taking our money. But here's what I think. Why do people continually do that? Aaron was telling me about one somebody that was a friend of one of his doctors that's a patient there. He had done a lot. He's up, I think he was up in his 80s or almost 90. And he'd done give him $500,000. Yeah, that's what I said. You know, and here's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking, you know, why are people so gullible? You know why? Because they don't listen. They don't grow. They don't learn. You know, we're the same way when it comes to the Bible a lot of times. When it comes to the things of Christ. We shouldn't be gullible. We should grow. We should learn. We should know what's going on around us. And the best way to do that is have conversation with the Lord and to read His Word. Not to be fooled by these things. Matthew 24:24 said this. He said, "For there shall arise false Christ, false prophets, and show great signs and wonders, insomuch if it was possible, they would deceive the very elect." The only way to keep it is the same scripture, but he said the only way for us to not get fooled is to really grow in Christ. If we don't grow, if we don't learn, we don't move forward, then we're going to be fooled. We're going to fall through some of these things. We're going to fall victim to a lot of the things that the old devil has to throw out there. If you find yourself repeatedly failing at the same thing, it's because we just don't bring it to Him. Or we just half-heartedly bring it to God. I tell people ask for help, and I talk to a lot of other preachers and a lot of other churches about helping others in the community. And I only have a few questions that we ask when we help somebody. If we help somebody financially, one thing I want to know is, how did you get here? What caused you to get in the place that you need help? If you can tell me that, then we can realize what caused you to get there. And then you'll be able to help me answer the second one. What are we going to do to help you to not get there again? Some people, they just don't have enough money coming in. Especially when it comes to elderly and people that are retired. There are programs that we can point you in the direction of to be able to help with some of those things. But unless we know those things, we can't figure it out. So here's what I say in our lives. Sometimes we just have to ask ourselves questions. How did I get here? What am I going to do to prevent this from happening again? I don't want it to happen again. Then I need to take the steps to get through this, whether it be temptation, whether it be trials, whatever it is. We do our best. I know the old devil comes out of the blue and throws things at us all the time. I was talking with somebody the other day, and I heard this statement a long time ago. It's talking about being late, and somebody was asking me if we have people that's continually late, and they had some that was continually coming in after services and all these things. And here's what somebody told me a long time ago. If you are the same time late every day, let's just say on your job or whether it's church or anywhere, if you're the same time late every day, you do it on purpose. You say, "Well, I don't mean to." That's not true. If you didn't mean to, you'd do something to stop it from happening. Same way with the finances. If we know how to fix it, and we know what caused it, then we'll do what we can to fix that. That's growth, amen? That's growth. He's on verse 15. He says, "But speaking the truth in love, may grow unto Him in all things, which is the head, even Christ." So he tells us here that all these things that we're doing and all these things that we're learning and the way that we're moving, we do those things in love. And we're not up here trying to hurt anyone, but we share these things out of love because we want you to grow. We want you to grow up. Same way with our children, right? We don't want them to stay babies forever. Now, sometimes when they get older, we wish they were back babies. When they're babies, we wish they'd get grown, right? I mean, that's just the way it works. So I told Sierra, was talking this evening, and she said she was looking at something for Riley for Christmas, and she said when she saw the price of it, she said, Grandma and Grandpa are going to have to get that. And I told somebody this week, I said, here's what you think about children. I said, you think when your children get grown, you'll have a little more money? You will, until they have grandchildren, and you'll spend twice as much on grandchildren as you did your own children. That's just the way it works. But here's what I say, we want our children to grow up, and we want them to get, we do everything we can to help them to grow up, and we teach them and train them that they can grow up and get out on their own, and all those things. Hey, it's the same way with us as Christians. We are to grow up that we can stand, and that we can be able to fight when the devil comes. We'll be prepared and ready to fight as the devil comes knocking, as he comes bringing things our way. But all the things that we do, and all the way that we treat others, and the way that we help others, we do that by speaking the truth in love. Amen. Some people, it is like the old movie cliche, some people just can't handle the truth. I understand that. Some people don't want to realize the truth. The truth does hurt, amen? Sometimes it will hurt in our life, but we are to speak the truth, but we are to speak it in love. We should never sound like we're trying to bash somebody over the head with it. We are to speak that in love. I told you the saying of this, in essentials, unity, in non-essentials, liberty, but in all things, charity. All things we do in love. And it helps people. That's what's different about us, because Christ lives in us. Speaking the truth in love, it's a principle that applies to every aspect of the Christian life. It's not just what we do here, but it's what we do out there in that community in the world where everybody else sees that and everybody else experiences that they might understand that we are Christian. Now, I'll be honest with you. I struggle with it sometimes, especially out there in this world, amen? Look, I'm a sledgehammer carrier, amen? Sometimes it's hard not to swat with a sledgehammer, but we ought to do that in love. We ought to do it in love. Whatever we do, we should do in love. Amen? Listen, he said, but speaking the truth in love, that we may grow up into all things, which is the head, even Christ. That way that when we begin to speak in love, I don't see anywhere. Now, I understand the Lord got angry. He turned the tables over. But he said, be angry and sin not. We can do those things in love. We can do the things, the ones he talked to, the ones that ridiculed him, the ones that persecuted him. He did it in love. He did it out of love. He goes on in verse number 16. He said, For whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplied, according to the effectual working and the measure of every part, make an increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. Now he is here in particular speaking about the body of Christ, which is the church, amen, he's speaking to the Ephesians over there. He's talking to them in that church and letting them know, hey, that we are all important. We all have roles and jobs in the body of Christ, in the church, in the body of his body. Things that need to be done, there's things that need to go out, we need to be out witnessing, we need to be a light in some other people's lives. Not everybody's the eye, not everybody's the ear. You know, you hear me say it all the time. We all have positions. We all have things that we can do. Even if it's simply praying for the others that are out there doing those things. Even if it is showing up. People don't realize how important showing up to church is, to the body of Christ. People don't realize how important it is for you to be obedient unto the Lord and put your tithes in an offering plate. Amen. How do you think the buildings, do you think the lights just match, they just give us power? They don't give us power, amen? It's all those. How do you think we go out and we take the youth and we do things with the youth? They don't just magically appear. How do you think we go out and we help people in the community? It doesn't just magically appear. How do you think that the ones that go out into the community, hey, it's important that we show up. It's important that we work together. It's important that we realize that we're fitly joined together. You ever had, is anybody here, have you ever had a joint out of place? Fingers, toes, you ever had anything broken? It don't feel good, does it? The rest of you know all about it. Have you ever had a splinter or something? A cut or a scratch. All those things affect how the rest of the body feel. All of the rest, not only how they feel, but how they function. When I've had broke bones, I've had all kinds of things happen. But here's what I want to say. All those things affect the way that we learn and the way that we act. It's important that each body is fitly joined together and performing the way God has given us the ability to perform. He said, according to the effectual working of the measure of every part. In other words, when we are fitly joined together and we are fitly working together and everybody's performing the way that it should, then you know what happens? We can see a lot accomplished. We can see a lot taking place. When a job calls for 5 people to do it, and only 1 or 2 show up, does the job still get done? Most of the time, yes. Most of the time, the job still gets done. But it does not get done in an efficient time, efficient way, or a safe way. Most of the time, it gets done. But I can tell you what, if the 5 had showed up and the 5 had worked together, it would have went along a lot better, a lot quicker. And we don't know what the outcome might have been, the things that we might have seen. Listen, all you have to do is be willing and we can see these things. And that's what Paul's talking about in the church. And I thank God that we have Hemlock like Baptist Church and the members that we do have. And I thank God for each one that fitly and jointly works together to see in the furthering of the kingdom of God. And it's not just for us. It's not that we might have a big church or say, hey, we've got this many. Look, what I want, you want to know what blesses my heart? I'll tell you what blesses my heart is to see people serving the Lord, doing what God would have them do. I'll tell you what blesses my heart, and it's important. You know, a couple Sundays ago, I got all the 19 and under standing up here. Did you realize how many 19 and under people were in this church that day? They are a part of this body of Christ. Some of them may not even know where they fit in yet. Some of them may not even know what their positions in the body of Christ are. Do you know what our job is? Our job is to teach them and train them to be able to do their parts. Amen. When you have a child and they are getting up to to the age of being able to walk, you do everything you can to teach that child to walk. Right? You want that child to walk. That's the way we are with Christians. That's the way we are with our young folks. It blesses my heart to see those up there, and it blesses my heart to see some that are doing what they can to train those children up and to teach those that they might be able, to move forward, that they might be able to see the church sustained if the time goes on, and not only for this generation, but for generations to come. I believe that's why it was so important, and I believe that's why Paul was so stressful in the way that he was delivering the message. It's time for us to grow up. It's time for us to fit together. And it's time for us to serve together. Has every head bowed, never eye closed, every Christian praying, every heart searching? I ask you tonight, how is it with you? Yes, how is it with you? Are you serving the way that you should serve? Are you going where you should go? Are you doing that which you should do? Listen, I want you to know tonight that we serve an awesome God. And we serve a God that loves us. We serve a God that is able to do that which is above anything that we can expect. This altar is open for anyone for any reason tonight. If you want to come out of that chair and out of that pew and get up here on this altar, here it is. We're not going to give a long invitation. We just want you to know that God loves you. We want you to know that God is here for you. want you to know that prayer changes things. Prayer changes things. What a God. Anybody else want to come before we pray? Brother Eddie, you pray for us.
Thank you.